So I'm here now between you and your lunch, and maybe let's do another session of stretches. No, just kidding. Well, I'm from QFED and CART, so it comes more naturally. I'm not here for that. I'm here today to talk about, as a practitioner, you're often faced with the choice of what database to choose for building that next system of yours, right? And what I want to share here is essentially learnings from my experiences from 2010 building Aadhaar, then building infrastructure services at Flipkart, and where I work currently, which is QFIT and health phase, about building data stores for healthcare, right? So there's a problem with my title, right? It says SQL and NoSQL. That's a very common accepted way of referring to relational and non-relational systems, because SQL just simply says what is a query language that you use, right? It doesn't define a class of systems, and we'll get to that. But in general, so the intent is help make our choices between relational and non-relational, the new SQL, NoSQL, whatever you want to call it, or whether you need to choose polyglot data stores to get your job done. So let's start with the landscape. This is again from one of the research outputs. So you see this, the purpose of putting this up is saying that this, your choice is just way too big, right? Between in-premise and hosted systems, and roughly classified between relational, non-relational, grid or caching zones, and some of them being in-premise and let's say hosted. So that really leaves us spoiled for choice. But the harder problem is, with every single vendor out there claiming that their solution is the best for your choice, how do you make that decision of what database to choose? Okay, so let's start off with some very basic ways of how you would start looking at database choices. And this is primarily, my talk is going to be more oriented towards in-premise choices, right, with some things that you can pick even from hosted solutions. So let's start off with some of the over the hood or the very obvious considerations that you make. So first and foremost is the kind of data manipulation language or the SQL or NoSQL choice that you're trying to make, right? So a query language of SQL, it might seem like that it's something of the last few decades, but trust me, it is very relevant. And why so? Because even Spanner, there's a real recent paper that says how Spanner is becoming a more SQL system, right? So SQL as a querying language of choice is not bad, right? So you want to make your choices of saying, hey, is my data more amenable for SQL-like queries? Now that's one choice that you would make. Or you would say, is it more suitable for a key value style operation, right? Get or put. Or even differently, if you're looking at some kind of a graph querying capabilities. And in my talk today, I'll be able to give you examples of some of these cases from real life where you will see that it is quite relevant and it's quite natural to look for a query language support that you would like to have. And another dimension is to look at bulk processing, both in loading and data export. And this can be for any number of reasons. You're trying to seed your database, you're trying to export the data out, take it somewhere. So it's good to get a first-hand view of saying, is that database choice of yours going to give you bulk data exports or transfers? The next one is asset properties, right? So asset, let's look at 1.0, asset properties. So there are the bunch of properties. What does that mean to database choice, right? So if you look at atomicity, it talks about, can be roughly translated into transaction support. Consistency would talk about ordering, whether you're going to be across, if there is replication, is it across replicas, is it going to be eventually consistent, is it going to be strongly consistent? Data staleness, and also durability talks about how durable is the data and can it survive crashes, right? So now when someone says that is it asset 1.0 compliant, then you can say that you get the following properties or you can expect the following properties from your data store. Now more recently, there's another proposal or in fact implementation of another set of properties called the asset 2.0. How many of you have heard of asset 2.0 here? Right. Now, asset 2.0 is more about its choice where typically is a matter of choice when you're trying to achieve scale, and more precisely when you're trying to achieve higher throughput, right? And in an asset 2.0 system where you say that, hey, data can be across replicas, can be associative, commutative, and the data gets relayed in a manner that's idempotent, and the data nodes themselves are distributed, right? What does this mean? It typically means transaction support is a little limited. And what I mean by this is, if you see in the asset 1.0 world, you could say that multiple inserts across multiple tables, inserts across multiple tables in a single instance is transactional, right? Versus in a 2.0 world, it is probably limited to saying that inserts only to specific records are transactional. Not saying that there aren't databases that offer that, but typically, right? It means that transaction support is limited. There is a relaxed ordering, right? Now, one of the reasons why Spanner has all this fancy infrastructure for GPS and atomic clocks is just to guarantee ordering. And because they claim that they're a globally consistent data store, and you want all replicas to converge and converge in time, right? So with relaxed ordering, you get higher throughput, and that also leads to another type. You can read that up called CRDTs, which are conflict-free replicated data types, and there is ready support for this in an open source system like React, right? Where those conflicts get thrown up to the application, and the application can then decide how it wants to resolve those conflicts. And at least once delivery guarantee. I very recently read that Kafka supports exactly once delivery semantics. That is very hard, or pretty hard to achieve, right? Just guaranteeing at least once delivery semantics itself is fairly complex, right? And what that means is, with at least once delivery semantics, what you get is mostly eventually consistent data stores, right? And this also can lead to higher availability. So you would start considering 2.0 properties when you're trying to achieve large scale. Otherwise, if the 1.0 properties work well, now that's fine too. Moving on, what do you expect in wire protocols, right? So wire protocols, most of them are custom protocols on top of TCP/IP, some of them work on gRPC, and there are very few that even work on say HTTP. Not much of a material difference in the choices that you're making, but it's good to be aware of what it is, right? Now, support for popular database protocols. And why is this relevant? So if you look at CockroachDB, they give you support for being used via the Postgres drivers. And this is primarily because, so that you're trying to make a shift from Postgres to CockroachDB, you could pretty much seamlessly use it and not make too many changes on your application layer. Right? So it is good to be aware, or let's say if I were to consider CockroachDB, I would say that, hey, it supports Postgres and I've been using Postgres, so it's good as a matter of choice as an end user, right? Or for that matter, Memcache. For a few years, it has always, Couchbase has been supporting Memcached as a protocol, right? So you could talk to Couchbase at the back end, but using the Memcached protocol. Or for that matter, standard interfaces, right? So in the Java world, JDBC is like a standard, and you have JDBC for all kinds of interface, right? Apache Hive has a JDBC driver. You have, for HBase, you have Phoenix, which gives a JDBC driver. Or if you look at Vitess, how many of you have heard of Vitess? Any of the Google, YouTube guys? Okay, so Vitess is a MySQL scaled solution built by YouTube and Google. And we came across this in Flipkart when we were trying to scale MySQL. And this does give you a SQL interface on top of an underlying MySQL based storage, but what it lacked was a JDBC driver. And while we were in Flipkart, our team built and contributed a JDBC driver for Vitess. So it basically allows you to scale MySQL in premise. So it means that across a number of instances, so if you're trying to build any of your custom sharding solutions, this is another viable option, right? But just a case in point where just building that JDBC support opened it out for a wider adoption within our company, where most of our instances were using MySQL, right? So you could say that, okay, it now has a compatible JDBC driver, and you can just shift on to that. So it's good to look for that as well. So on schema, so I sometimes hear this, right? Like schema is evil, right? My system is not able to scale because it is relational, it is very schema defined, and therefore it's a problem. But the truth is, if you really look at number of systems that really need schema-less backends, you can count them, like they're very few, right? So either they're sparse metric, or you're trying to look to build entity value, entity attribute value storage. Like for example, like we started off in Flipkart, our catalog used to be something. If you're trying to store, let's say a diaper and an iPhone 6 on the same catalog system, we started off with an EAV store, but then just that couldn't scale, and then later we built something else, right? So for these kind of system, arguably you have a need for a schema-less system, and you say that, okay, there are a lot of changes, so frequent changes you would go and use such a schema-less store, right? So I'm here, there might be fans here of document databases like MongoDB, and they would argue that it works very well for this kind of requirement, right? Now, what do you lose if you don't have schema, right? And very interestingly though, I think as of 2017, Mongo has announced support for schemas in their database, right? Why that is so? Because in the absence of schema, understanding the data becomes incredibly hard. And what becomes even worse is you have wrongly typed data going into any of these fields, and then when you're trying to make sense of this data when you're querying, it becomes next to impossible. So you're actually making you're doing all the hard work when you're querying the data. So schema itself is not bad. You really need to be convinced that if you're going for schema-less, why are you going for schema-less, and be prepared to pay the price for going schema-less. Or there's an in-between path, right? So for the ones which use columnar data stores, they require, and you require column indices, for example, right? So if you look at a database like HBase or let's say Cassandra, they allow you to define indices on top of those column families. Why? Because you're trying to query them, you're trying to make that more efficient. Then this like kind of an in-between world where you're trying to optimize on both storage as well as on query. Right? So schema, therefore, is not evil, and it is perfectly okay to expect or look for schema support in the database that you're looking for. The other one, CAP theorem, right? I'm sure by now all of us would be aware of what's CAP theorem, but there's an interesting point about not taking it in an absolute literal sense, and there's a debate about saying, is CP really achievable or not, and so on. But what I liked is in one of these papers, and those references are there, like I found that it is one good example of a fundamental trade-off between safety and liveness in fault-prone systems. That's exactly what CAP theorem is, right? It's trying to define, when you say safety, it's talking about consistency, and liveness, it's talking about availability. And when you say fault-prone systems, it says that when network partitions can occur, right? So that's the way to look at it. If you just look at the conjecture that Brewer proposed, it is too simplistic to say one is achievable versus not, and therefore it's like kind of too simplistic at face value. There are enough examples where, anyway, CA is impractical because if you're in a distributed world, if you don't go beyond a single node, then you know the CA is pretty much non-practical. But CAP availability and CAP consistency is actually a spectrum and is never and not binary. And I'll give that as an example, right? So if you look at AP reads and AP writes. Now, AP reads, there are enough examples, right? So you can say that I have a cache, so long as the entire system is available, it's partition tolerant, and I trade off consistency acceptable. What's a good example of AP writes, right? I've seen one very good example, and probably that affects all of us here, is I've read this. Of the number of users who use Uber, and I know there are a bunch of Uber friends here. So I believe they built a system for captioning the rides when you complete a ride. Right? When you complete a ride, when you probably swipe and you say that you're completing the ride, what is very, very important is to capture that ride. Because the customer is not going to wait, the cab driver is not going to wait. It's very important that you capture the ride, and the ride can go to any copy among the available nodes, and with mechanisms like hinted handoffs, finally the data reaches the eventual state. You may not be able to read the data right away, but the write is super important. So AP itself is, therefore you'll see that in these two examples of a cache scenario versus like a Uber-like example, it is a spectrum, right? And so therefore CAP, even with CAP, you go and critique your data sources to see what is it that matters to you more, right? So it's never a binary, right? And then with that, you define your application trade-offs, right? You impact, validate impact on your NFRs, latency, and I can give you many examples. Again, if I go back to the Flipkart example, so we have systems where, like even on pricing, well, not so much on pricing, but I think definitely on offers, we chose to have availability over consistency, right? And we built systems for that. And that's perfectly all right. And you will define those trade-offs when you're trying to critique it using CAP. And that also serves as a good starting point for considering, right, polyglot persistence. So what I mean by polyglot persistence is something like this. So this is from Aadhaar. So in 2010, 2012, when we built the system, when we looked at the data here, so there is the raw biometric data, the enrollment data, which is roughly now, I think, at 1 billion enrollments, it's probably about a few petabytes, right? So that needs to be archived for 7 years. So that sits on an NFS, and I'll talk about why an NFS versus an HDFS. So this is like an archive store. The same data first actually comes into HDFS for very high throughput processing. The biometric extracts, so those of you who have used your other authentication, the authentication is happening against HBase. So that data is on HBase. The master Aadhaar data is on MySQL. We have indexes, it's no longer Mongo, so it's a little dated, but that's again MySQL. And then we have a query on top which allows you to do all kinds of searches, albeit in a very secure way, on like if you lose your enrollment slip and somebody doesn't have it, how do you find your Aadhaar record, right? So it's the same data, or rather the extracts of it, which sits in a highly polyglot store, and the data progresses through various layers. Another concept here is called CQRS. How many of you have heard of CQRS? Awesome. So it basically means command and query responsibility separation. So which means that, yeah, in terms of operations, it's like write and get, read. Yes, obviously operations are separate, but what if your data stores themselves are separate, right? And CQRS essentially promotes that. And a number of systems today exist that allow you to realize this, and I think Lagom, if I'm right, among the more recent frameworks gives you first class support for CQRS. Basically what it says is saying that you have writes going into a data store, and from there those are commands, and there is a continuous update of those changes going into a read store so that you can serve the reads of a completely different infrastructure. And what you're seeing to the right is essentially the system that Flipkart has on its for its catalog. And this system at peak has served like 10 million reads per second, right? That's the read pipeline, and what you're seeing at the bottom, which is highly replicated, highly distributed clusters sitting on Redis and with virtual buckets managed by the application layer, while the writes or the whole data that gets stored sits on HBase, Elasticsearch, and gets orchestrated through a write pipeline, along with, you know, write repair happening across these clusters. So this is one example of basically using a polyglot store, applying techniques of CQRS, right? So that's another one where without you having to engineer it yourself. Now this is an example of some work that I'm currently doing at QFIT, which is we are trying to build a knowledge graph which will eventually be used for such things like an automated symptom diagnosis system, and which can even aid the doctor in disease analysis, right? I hate to use the word AI, but this is basically a data-driven diagnosis system which with no human intervention. And that talks about first establishing a graph of the sorts, which kind of says, hey, you have flu, and flu as a condition has symptoms like cold, body ache, headache, and so on, right? So very naturally represented as a graph, And what you're trying to do with this, and we built it, and this uses Titan as its storage, and we chose Titan for multiple reasons, right? One is, it could be packed with Cassandra, and Cassandra, as we know it, is an AP system, so very nicely maps with what we're trying to do here. Here, more than the staleness of data, what we care about is availability of data. Works well for single query hops, like what we're trying to do here, which is like once in flu, you're trying to traverse to, let's say, cold or body ache and headache. And for a system like this, you can create very interesting solutions on top. But here, with Titan, the point I was trying to make was, with Titan, the underlying storage, you have a choice of either Cassandra or HBase, and for indexing, it's on Elasticsearch, right? So it's again polyglot persistence. Under the hood, you didn't make a choice, but it's a case where it isn't a single bundled storage engine. So a couple of other things to look at is performance benchmarks, right? In general, benchmarks by vendors are lies, and more lies. Right? Why? Because they have a job to sell their databases, so they'll try to take the most ideal case of databases and then, you know, workloads and try to prove that it's right for them. But I found that independent benchmarks are very useful. Like, there was a recent benchmark on graph databases, and somebody proved that if you can actually implement a graph for certain workloads on, let's say, a Postgres without even going towards a Berkeley DB, or let's say, I think they even picked Neo4j and Titan with Cassandra backend. Those graph queries actually work better with a relational data store as its underlying storage, right? Like Facebook Tau database, for example. It's a graph database built on MySQL. So it does help. You might still make your decision or your choice to go with whatever, right? Like reading this report, I would still go with Titan over Cassandra. But why? Because I don't have to build the underlying graph storage layer on top of, let's say, MySQL or Postgres. But it's really good to be aware of these kind of benchmarks and use them in your, you know, in your choices. Operations and maintenance. This is interesting, right? So you look at Facebook with all of their engineering prowess, they didn't go and build a storage layer for Tau, right? They went and built it on top of MySQL. Same with the LinkedIn guys, they built Espresso and built it on top of SQL. And if you look at their engineering blog, and those posts will show you that, both of them built it on MySQL as a storage engine. And why do they do that? They say, hey, we have expertise managing MySQL as a storage engine. We know what to do when you have to replicate data, when you have to restore data. So we would rather use that to build our storage as the storage engine and then build our whatever layer on top, right? Whether it's a document DB in case of a LinkedIn Espresso, or let's say it's a graph database in case of Facebook. And the other important thing is support. Support, either it's paid or whether it's a community. And community where if it is paid, whether it's single vendor versus multiple vendor, and community, again, the size of the community matters a lot, right? Though you would see that a lot of the databases would claim that they are open source, but the only company supporting it would be the guys who created it, right? Now that really doesn't speak too much of a large community backing it. The fourth one is a hosted service, right? So coming to this, so when we chose Titan with Cassandra as a storage, Titan interestingly also has storage implemented on top of DynamoDB. Right? And if you were to deploy and operate on AWS, then I already have a service that can be managed by someone else. Right? So that's a matter of choice in a public cloud. So it says that, hey, it really works. Right? So that's some, again, to look at when you're making a choice. But from here, we'll move on to some of the under the hood considerations, right? Additional things that you generally look for in addition to what were the fairly obvious things. Now comes the database part, right? So between a relational database and a columnar database, it helps to understand how is data stored internally and in the storage layer. So relational, quite naturally, if you look at it, data is stored where all the data in a row is stored together. So which means if there's going to be a disk seek or transfer, it's going to operate at a record level. Versus in a columnar store, all column data is stored together. And why so? Because when you're trying to do OLAP queries, you're trying to do group by, you're trying to do any of those count and any of those aggregate queries, more suitable for a columnar storage, and that's why very, very likely that you'll see most of your OLAP databases having, making a choice of using a columnar storage at the underlay layer, right? And it gives better query compression and so on and so forth. It definitely helps to know what is the underlying storage engine or the, what does the storage layer look like for the database of your choice. It also comes with a few trade-offs, and a case in point, like suppose you're trying to build a data store, like let's say other is fine, but if you look at that data, you're trying to retrieve a record at a time, a relational store, because it uses a B-tree kind of a store, is probably more efficient than a columnar data store, for example. Now moving on to document, so we have four classes, right? So you have relational, columnar, document, and key value. So document is essentially a subclass of a key value store. Data is organized from a DB to a collection to a document. It sometimes have challenges in optimizing storage, right? Because they don't have a data dictionary, so it becomes rather hard to define how do you optimize it for storage level. Now comes the key value stores, often RAM based, and you see that with key value stores, if you really start looking deep, how many of them give you high guarantees of data durability? And I wouldn't expect them to give that, because they are by design, they're meant to give you very low latency reads, right? You're saying that sub millisecond or sub 2 millisecond reads, they largely try to keep the data in memory. So which means then when you do a write, it's quite likely that writes get batched and then they get flushed to disk. And if you say replicas, if you're trying to say something, hey, I require a key value store, which is going to give me very high durability guarantees, where the durability is down to disk and is also distributed. Then imagine the cost of doing that, right? It has to do an RPC, send the data across nodes, and also do a flush to disk. Most of them, while they do, probably might give you the way to tune that kind of durability. Key value stores are better suited for mostly in-memory read-writes with kind of batched flushes to the disk. So data organization, now this is another interesting topic, where if you look at a number of relational stores, they organize data in more like of a B-tree format. And in more recent times, you'll see a lot of these databases trying to use the log structured format, right? And why log structured format? It is for multiple reasons. It started off as being log structure for having very high throughput writes, like a HBase or a Cassandra. They started off using log structured formats for doing the writes. But interestingly, databases like even RocksDB or LevelDB, right, use a log structured format. The reason being, most of them are built for storage on SSDs. And on SSDs with write amplification and your write cycles that you have, a log structured storage format is better suited and gives you more life as compared to in-place updates that you would probably see in a relational store, right? And log structured also means that your data is mostly keyed by the primary key. So that's why if you see a HBase or a Cassandra, retrieval by the primary key is super easy. Secondary indices, even though they provide that, the lookups aren't just as fast. So we'll talk about that later, but generally it's also good to see that what is the underlying data organization on disk. You'll see more and more recent databases having LSM trees. Next one is on replication and consensus. So replication is, so if you're trying to say that you have a globally replicated, completely consistent database, then it means that you're trying to say that somewhere that the replication is possibly, I don't know, I've not read it in detail, but probably spanner replication is probably, it is like sync replication versus a number of the databases that we know uses async replication, right? And number of replicas, the number of copies of the data that you have, guaranteed writes, hinted handoffs. So all of these are attributes that if you care to read about mostly the open source databases, the white paper, the engineering blogs about them, you will get to see these common things emerging, right? And it always helps to make sense of the kind of guarantees that you can get from the database. Or whether it's a single master read write, like for example, HBase achieves consistency by being a single master read write, which means it's a single copy of data always is the read and write, all reads and write just go to that copy. On consensus, it's used in leader election, and I know that there's this talk of Paxos. So now on Paxos, if I say how many of us have heard of Paxos? Show of hands, please. How many of us understand Paxos? Not me, right? Incredibly complex as a consensus protocol, and and what you would see is that there are newer protocols like Raft, which are also employed for doing this consensus and leader election. It does help to understand replication. What is the kind of consensus protocol in use? Because you'll see that sometimes because of a wrong choice of a consensus protocol, the database can actually be, can perform very badly or perform very poorly when it comes to the safety guarantees. And if you care to look at it, look at Jepsen tests. Again, show of hands, who's heard of Jepsen tests? It's about, very interesting, just read up Jepsen tests. Probably you'll not sleep that night, right? You might have chosen a database, and if you read the Jepsen test results, you'll see that, oh my God, what did I choose? But the good part is what started off as just a critique of those databases. Today you have a number of databases actually come and claim, saying that my database has basically adhered to all of the Jepsen tests, right? And there are enough examples. Jepsen basically started off by the work of one single guy, Kyle Kingsbury. So look it up and do read about Jepsen test results for the database that you're trying to pick. Running out of time, so you're also trying to look at data export and restore. Like primarily if you have strong RPO and RTO, you know, requirements and a DR scenario, look for tools that provide full export versus incremental snapshot, tools for restoring from export. And all these things start to matter when you're looking at very large database sizes, right? Like multiple terabytes of data, you're trying to optimize and you're trying to actually ship data. Like here I had a point about large scale data migration. So there's a reference of when we did the Flipkart data center migration, we actually took disks in a truck. Right, it was the fastest bandwidth throughput that we could ever get for transferring data from point A to point B. Right, so it does matter to look at these tools for data transfer and migration. Right, another aspect is the mean time to recovery, which is really the time that you take to, let's say, promote a hot standby to master, let's say in a MySQL scenario, and that in Vitus as an example is like a click of a button. You can promote a MySQL standby to a master by the click of a button. Now that says something about how you can manage and keep your operations running, right? So it's good to detect failure and validate and promote to a new master or leader. Cost, disk memory ratios. So going back to an Aadhaar again, we store the data on, we moved out of HDFS and moved to disk because to keep such a large cluster operational, the amount of compute that you would have to dedicate to HDFS is more. So instead, it is cheaper to move it to an NFS filer, right? So it's good to look at those examples and the amount of data that you can hold in memory and the kind of addressable ratios that you can have. Now, power consumption, you'll see that in very large data centers, when they say that we'll give you SSD disks, they're actually doing themselves a favor because it's more power efficient to run SSDs than to run spinning disks, right? And if you look at Glacier store, and there are some references there, very, very interesting, like the Facebook, the way they store photos, not all disks in the rack are even powered up, right? They try to optimize that because it's super critical when you're trying to create such large dense storage. Last one is on to look for some DB-specific optimizations. If you really see, you're trying to look at how effectively can you use memory and reduce access to disk or optimize access to disk, right? So if you look at memory, so it all translates to data blocks or block cache, buffer pools. There are enough guidelines around how much buffer pool size you want to give to a MySQL instance, or in case of HBase, like what is the size of the block cache, because it reduces disk IO, provides lower latency reads, and also potentially lower latency because of high data locality of reference, right? There are a few references to go read up more on that, but effectively what you're trying to do is try to keep data and optimize for keeping data in memory as much as possible and not hit disk. And if you do have to hit disk, techniques like Bloom filters, right, saying which of those data blocks actually contain the data, either you have indexes or you have optimistic data structures like Bloom filters, which again tell you that, hey, there's a good possibility that this data exists in this block, but you can get a false positive, but never a false negative. right? So these kind of optimizations, and if you read again about databases, they'll say that there is support for, let's say in HBase, support for Bloom filters at a column family level, right? And you'll know why that is for. They're just trying to optimize on the disk seek and the data blocks that you have to read. So that's just a couple of things, but in essence, what it means is the kind of levers that you have in order to minimize the access to disk, and specifically disk seek times more than transfer, and the kind of levers that you can you know, employ as an end user. And that actually takes me to the end of, this is definitely not a comprehensive list, but a bunch of things that you can look at both over the hood and under the hood when you make your next database choice. Some references, I mean, it's there all over the talk, so interesting reads. If you go and start looking into each one of them, you'll be able to relate to the various topics that I've covered in the, you know, the last 30 minutes. So with that, I'm done. Open to any questions.
Questions and answers. If anybody has a question, please raise your hand and we'll get you a mic. Wow, it's an entire auditorium without a single question. Oh wait, there's a question right
Hello.
There.
Hello.
Just people are hungry. Yes.
It's almost lunchtime. You could almost leave.
Hi. Hello, check. At the last here.
Oh, yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Okay, so I just have one question, or I don't know, more like a feedback that I want to ask or give. So at one point you talked about LSM structures, right? And you said we prefer LSM for the better lifetime of SSDs because compare that to like in-point updates.
In-place updates.
In-place updates. Can you explain how exactly that happens? I mean, because with LSM you generally have a process that comes along with it called the process of compaction, where you end up rewriting the files by taking deltas over again. Whereas in-place updates is all about doing random writes.
Yeah, so random writes actually results in write amplification, right? Whereas in when you do the compaction the way you describe it in an LSM, it writes larger blocks, so the write amplification is significantly reduced.
The Paxos protocol we are talking about, and where you said Raft and Zab are also, maybe you might have listed as three protocols, but Raft and Zab are just variations of Paxos, so we just need to keep that in mind.
Sure.
So Raft is just a way to simplify Paxos. And
yeah, I just as an end user found it a lot more easier to even make an attempt understanding Raft.
Got it.
Paxos, maybe, I don't know. It's so incredibly hard.
Sure.
But the point more was to see what is the strength of the replication protocol. So if a database were to come and tell me that they use Paxos for both leader election and replication, I know that those guys have done some very serious engineering work. Right? Whereas let's say I know Elasticsearch used to use a replication protocol which was very fault prone. And that was came out in the Jetson test.
I'd like to thank you very
thank
much.
You.
We will have a Q&A.